Hello, welcome to our European Court of Human Rights and the COVID-19, which is organized science and the site of juridice.ro. I am Julia Motok. I am judge currently at the European Court of Human Rights, and I am professor at the University of Bucharest. I am delighted to welcome our very distinguished speakers of today. How to start a conference about COVID? Telling that when the hospital were filling up fast as COVID-19 began to spiral of control, sales of Albert Camus' 1947 novel, La Peste, were raising. Its fictive chronicle of the measure taken in the city of Oran against the death-dealing disease that strikes in 1940 sometimes seemed to blur into the government announcement reshaping our life. Oran is a city like anywhere else, Camus said. And I will say now in French, as Camus wrote, nos concitoyens travaillent dur, mais uniquement dans le but de s'enrichir. Leur principal intérêt est le commerce et leur objectif principal dans la vie est, comme ils l'appellent, faire des affaires. Like people anywhere else, the Oranians are completely unprepared where rats began emerging for the sewers to die. The people of Oran initially disbelieved the plague outside of the page of history books. So, like many nations in 2020, they are slow to accept the enormity of what is occurring. As Camus continue, and now I'll say in English, in this respect, they were wrong, and their views obviously called for revision. So COVID-19 had barely affected those of the top end of the global economy and has devastating effect on the bottom parts of our economy and society, said Stiglitz, Professor Stiglitz, to the Human Rights Council. He also remembered that it almost part of a right to life and yet access to the vaccine, while it's very easy in advanced country, is extraordinary social welfare and vulnerability, which including essays of a social determinants of health and corrosive nature of disadvantage, of vulnerability of children during school closure and right to adequate housing. A very important theme of vulnerability regarding to the question of the COVID that was reminding from the beginning in the Human Rights Council was the question of economic justice and includes discussion of precarity, theme of in speech and misinformation, which examine issues such as what efforts to repress misinformation about COVID-19 on social media violates freedom of speech and moral permissibility of shaming those who flout social distancing guidelines. A disproportionate number of 3 million people worldwide who have died for COVID-19 are also victims of inequalities. So we have all these numbers, and we know that despite a surplus of vaccine in the rich world, the global south has fewer than the tiny amount that led to expect. So this is the global picture of the COVID-19, the global picture of the COVID-19, especially in the relationship between the North and the global South, and to see which are the consequences today for our society and for developing the problem of the related to COVID-19. Dealing with the pandemic through the prism of law is not an easy task, especially when you consider where we stand. We are not at the time of taking stock, nor we are at the stage of mere production and even fiction. We are, unfortunately, still in what Shakespeare described in The Tempest, what's past is prologue. The fundamental rights and human rights obligation of Romania as a EU member state also derive for other international human rights instruments. This includes the European Convention on Human Rights, the European Social Charter Treaty System, as well as instruments adopted within the framework of the United Nations, such as the International Convention on Civil and Political Rights and Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. In addition, fundamental and human rights are well entrenched in the constitution and legislation of the EU member state. They are also part of their common values of which EU is founded. International Court has referred to the negative duty of the state not to infringe the ability to access healthcare. the International Court of Justice, the ICJ, determining an Israeli war advisory opinion, legal consequences of the construction of the wall in the occupied Palestinian territory, that Israel's erection of a separate barrier between West Bank and Israel restricts access to health services and thus violate the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights in this Article 12, the right to health. Our court, the European Court of Human Rights, has at least once interpreted the European Convention on Human Rights as imposing health-related duties on state part, once before the pandemic. The court grand chamber held in Genk versus Turkey that Turkey had not taken sufficient care to ensure the health system functioned appropriately. Researchers have suggested that despite the absence of an explicit right to health in the European Convention on Human Rights, prior court judgment can be read as extracting a positive duty to health protection for state party based on Article 5, Paragraph 1, right to liberty and security. This is also to discuss. Further, the right to health is not solely positive, but there is a strong presumption that retrogressive measures taken in relation to the right to health are not permissible, and state parties should refrain from interfering directly or indirectly with the enjoyment of the right to health. Regarding our court, we have to say that we already receive around 307 requests for interim measure related to COVID-19 health crisis. The majority of these requests were based off Article 2, right to life, or Article 3, prohibition of torture, and were made either by migrants or detainee. The first measure, the first Article Section 39 benefit were granted in cases against Greece, 50 cases against Greece. Asylum seeker or people held in traffic or assessment center were asking to be released due to the overcrowding, lack of infrastructure, and risk of contamination of COVID. The court took into account the particular vulnerable situation of certain applicants, of minor with mental problem, of elderly, pregnant women, and women with newborns, and ordered Greece to offer the reception condition and the care compatible with their state of health. Other measures follow this kind of measure, but majority of them, they deal with this category of vulnerable people like migrants or detainees. A lot of other complaints were communicated, but by now the court had decided in few of them. The court, for instance, held that there had been a violation of Article 3, prohibition on human on degrading treatment of the convention on account of the applicant in acquitted condition of detention in a Maltese case. The court was concerned about the applicant assertion, not rebutted by the Maltese government, that following an isolation period, the applicant has been moved to other living quarters for where new arrival had been kept in COVID-19 quarantine. There was no indication that the period, which moreover had lasted nearly 7 weeks, thus the measure of placing him for several weeks with other persons who could have posed a risk to his health in the absence of any relevant consideration to that effect could not be considered a measure complying with basic sanitary requirements. So we found a violation of Article 3. Other complaints now that are communicated under Article 3 follow a request for extradition to the United States of a 60-year-old man suffering from pathologies, asthma and diabetes, and likely to suffer as a result of a pandemic in human condition and degrading. Violation of Article 11, freedom of assembly and association, following a general ban of all public demonstration, which forced the applicant, a worker defense association, to cancel a demonstration if they wanted to organize. Also violation of Article 5, right to liberty and security, invoked by the applicant imprisoned in Cyprus, whose extradition to Russia was suspended due to health crisis. Violation of Article 8, right to respect for private and family life, invoked by a father who, in the context of his legal separation procedure, wanted justice to rule urgently on the custody of his 5-year-old daughter, taken by his wife away from him. Violation of Article 10, freedom of expression, following an Instagram post that was sanctioned by the court for exposing figures of virus contamination and virus-related death deceptively inflated by authorities. So right to protect health, as we said, by the 47 signatory states of the European Convention, must adopt a regulation applying in places where health must be guaranteed. And we have several judgments of our court when we speak about goals to be protected. And our colleague, the judge Wikström Moru, has identified the ultimate goal to protect the life of patients, Article 2. We refer to, for instance, to the judgment López de Sousa and Fernando de Oliveira against Portugal, the end of life situation and interruption of the life support system that have given rise to particularly difficult situation, like in cases like Lambert versus France and Guard versus UK. Under the prohibition of inhuman and degrading treatment, the court has to deal with the expulsion of seriously ill persons, like in Popashvili versus Belgium or Savran versus Denmark. There are some of very interesting cases that point out Article 8, especially that the last case that we had during the pandemic released in April 2018, Vavrika versus Czech Republic. So we have to recall this case. This case is very important. It was not always interpreted in the right way. So in the Czech Republic, there is a general legal duty to vaccinate children against 9 diseases that are well known to medical science. Compliances with that duty cannot be physically enforced. Parents who fail to complain without good reason can be fined. Non-vaccinated children are not accepted in the nursery school. An exception is made for those who cannot be vaccinated for health reasons. In the case of Vavrika, the first applicant was fined for failure to complain with the vaccinated duty in relation to his children, and the other applicants were all denied admission to nursery school for the same reason. In this case, the court pointed out that under the case law, compulsory vaccination as involuntary medical intervention represents an interference with physical integrity and thus concern the right to respect for private life protected by Article 8 of the Convention. It recognized that the Czech policy pursued the legitimate aim of protecting health as well as the right of others, noting the vaccination protects both those who receive and those who cannot be vaccinated for medical reasons, and therefore relying on herd immunity for protection against serious contagious. And the court considered that a wide margin of appreciation was appropriate for the respondent state in this context. It could be said that representing that the national authorities answer to the pressing social need to protect individual and public health against the diseases in question and to go down against trend in the rate of vaccination among children. So the court observed that the vaccination duty concerned 9 diseases against which vaccination was considered effective and safe by the scientific community. And the court examined the proportionality afterwards of the vaccine policy. On a general level, it noted that the scope and the content of the duty to vaccine, the existing exception of for it procedural safeguards available. So in this case, as you all know, the court has said that we don't have a violation of Article 8.8. What is very important to notice is that the court in this case had dealt extensively with the question of the right of children and the best interest of children in the convention, and with the question of the proportionality of the vaccine, of this particularly 9 vaccine. So it is nothing that can be interfere for this other kind of vaccination from this judgment, as it was sometimes reported by some experts or by the press by that time. So we should also bear in mind that we have several other circumstances, other jurisdiction that were and are confronted with the question of the compulsory vaccination. And we have this in Europe, we have less case law regarding this question, but we will always have debate that invoke the possibility to raise the freedom of conscience that is recognized by the Article 9 of the European Convention on Human Rights, and the problem of the right of conscience objection that is so well represented in our case law, especially following the case of Batayan versus Armenia. But we have this case law, as you know, probably in the United States, when recently on the 29th of October, the Supreme Court declined an application for emergency relief to block the state of Maine mandate for healthcare workers to be vaccinated against the coronavirus, a requirement that allow non-religious exemptions. So we see that in this case, the Supreme Court agree with the Maine policies that mandate healthcare workers to be vaccinated against the coronavirus. Of course, we have the three judges that are dissenter, especially talking about religious belief, but the decision of the court is such as I said. So we have a federal appellate court that in the October 29 removed a temporary order that has let healthcare workers in New York seek religious exemption to the state COVID-19 vaccination mandate. And New York law now permits exemption only for medical but not religious reasons. So before even on the 1st of October, the Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor declined to block New York City COVID-19 vaccination mandate for all City of Department of Education employees. So we see that the Supreme Court is keeping the same case law in this direction, interpreting the legislation in this direction. This is the reason why also American authorities and President Biden believe that putting a mandate of which would make businesses with 100 or more employees requiring their staff to get vaccinated, it will be a positive measure to hasten the end of the coronavirus pandemic. The situation is different in Europe, to come back. So we know that in order to assess this limitation to freedom, the court must weigh accordingly to the formula established by our case law, competing rights, competing health, collective health versus individual freedoms. This balancing act finds its architectural expression in two areas of justice that make up the building of the European Court of Human Rights. It's the foundation of all the right for justice of our convention. We have another question here facing in the convention that maybe is a little bit more complicated, and five of our speakers will talk about this, is regarding the request of the judge of the declaration of derogation in conformity with Article 15 of the Convention. Article 15 of our Convention is a tool available to states which allow certain rights of the Convention to be derogated from in the event of exceptional and imminent crisis or danger. From the first judgment in the history in 1961, Lawless versus Ireland, the court was required to frame the exception decided in the name of urgency. It is in the difficult political context, which was the conflict in North Ireland. The development of the disease, starting with the pandemic, 10 member states of the Council of Europe, Albania, Armenia, Estonia, Georgia, Latvia, North Macedonia, Moldova, Romania, Republic of San Marino, and Serbia, has declared to the Secretary General of the Council of Europe that they could take measures derogating for the obligation of the convention. The concept of a state of exception has a very long history. Since discussion upon can be traced back to the French Revolution, it defines as a special condition in which the juridical order is actually suspending due to an emergency or a serious crisis prevailing on the other, on the basic laws and norms can be violated by the state while facing the crisis. The idea that the exception is a fundament of law has been formulated more recently by Agamben, George Agamben, but has been developed by the famous philosopher and, of course, crown jurist of the Reich, Carl Schmitt, and by Walter Benjamin in the first decades of the 20th century. Agamben started now his inquiry about theoretical perspective, aiming at the formulation of a general theory of a state of exception, which he claims had become the dominant paradigm of the government in contemporary politics. He reads the emergence of the exception in Foucauldian senses. He focuses on the famous notion of biopolitical significance of exceptionalism as a widespread political device. For Agamben, such suspension of a law is pivotal to its directly affect the people's life, not only the subject of politics as citizen, but as human being as such. The locus where people are striped to bear life, as defined by him, are concentration camp in Nazi Germany. So we see completely different situation. The same theory of the state of exception is less known, but was developed also by the concept of necropolitics in the use of social and political power to dictate to some people may live or must die, of the philosopher Achille Mbembe, in the author of the book on the postcolonialism and of the book in 2019 about necropolitics. He also in his book discussed the extension of biopower, the Foucauldian term, and also the question of controlling people's life, but especially the problem of the fact that under the condition of the necropower, the lines between resistance and suicide, sacrifice and redemption are blurred. He discussed the obligation of the countries they have in theory not to expose their citizen to death, which happened in a lot of with a lot of countries. Following advices from international and European health institutions, more member states have used digital tracing and tracking tools to limit the spread of the pandemic, especially contact tracing application. Some countries have also allowed health and policy authorities to access traffic data and geolocalization data provided by telecommunication operators to track certain individuals subject to quarantine measures. Regarding contact tracing application in the context of the COVID-19, the European Convention and the European Data Protection have adopted guidance on how to comply with the data protection standards, because of course this implies the GDPR and also the question of the EU Charter. Another question is the death of extraterritorial application of the context of the COVID-19. I think that my colleague Jess Abbato will speak about this. So talking about the underlying intent of the convention and general content, we see the possibility to see also an extraterritorial application in the context of COVID-19. To conclude, I will say that for the first time in the very long time, philosophical consideration has become the stuff of political debate and everyday conversation. The word seems stemmed by ethical consideration. Is there a right thing? And the word says teeming to do. And they are now everyday question for most people, and many politicians in particular standing accused of having done the wrong thing, the wrong decision. So ethical things, philosophy can help to inform and what we want to do given what we know. So ethical and philosophy things, also philosophy of law, became everyday question for every of us.